Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. It's great to see so many of you here today. Just a couple of quick reminders. If you have not scanned or signed in yet, Michael over here will take your student ID numbers down. If you are here because of a DPDP, Daniel's Professional Development Requirement, if you do not record your number, you won't get credit for attending today. So just make sure that you do that. We're going to go ahead and get started because we're just a couple minutes behind. So I'm going to turn the time over to Venetia.
Awesome. All right. Thank you all so much for coming. My name is Professor Venetia Dutra. I am a faculty member in the finance department, and I am here joined by Mr. Jeff Woods, who is one of the career coach over in Career Services, which is on the second floor over in Daniels. Okay. And I'm also accompanied by Mr. Ali Machado. He is our new internship coordinator, director. So if you are interested in doing an internship, you have to go through him. He'll talk a little bit about that a little down the line, okay? So we are here collectively representing the Ryman School of Finance, which is on the fifth floor of Daniels, all right? First thing we're gonna do is just talk briefly about what finance is and the paths that you can take with a finance degree. Then I'll turn it over to Jeff, and he'll talk about careers in this space, okay? Let me mention now that if you have questions, please do not be shy about raising your hand and interrupting us. We are here for one purpose, and that is to disseminate information. You're here to gain that information, so don't be shy, okay? If you have a question about anything, stop us. Raise your hand, just ask, all right? No one bites you. All right, so the first question you may have is, what exactly is finance? Some of you in here are already declared finance majors, but some of you aren't sure. Your first years, and you haven't decided which major you wish to declare. So if you are already a finance major, this may be repetition for you, but just hang on with us, all right? So the first question you may have is, what is it to be a finance major? What does it mean to major in finance? And finance is a very broad term, but in general, it deals with the operations of funding an entity. So a corporation or business, or maybe governments, they all need to raise capital in order to implement their projects or to push forward an agenda, okay? So it's the study of raising that capital and then how to manage that capital, okay? Now, if you choose the finance major here within Daniels, there are generally two tracks you can take. One is the corporate track, the other is the investment track, okay? And under each, I'll describe the courses very briefly, but there are a set of five core courses that you will be required to take, okay? The first one is FIN 3110. This is our financial institutions course. This course teaches you about financial institutions, those institutions that are key to making sure our financial markets operate efficiently. So here you will learn about what a bank is. You'll learn about all of the banking operations. You'll learn about the importance of that function. You'll also learn about, let's say, the Federal Reserve. Okay, very topical, something we pay attention to for many reasons. So you'll learn about the institutions that operate within our financial markets. Then you have 3200, 3300. 3300 is investments. 3410 is multinational, so you'll learn about financing at the global stage. There is an accounting requirement in the finance major, and this accounting 3220 is about understanding how to read and interpret financial statements. Okay, so accounting is critical to doing anything in finance. You can't value a corporation unless you can understand how to break down those financial statements. Okay, so these are required. If you were to take the corporate track, then you have a couple of courses. These are both electives. All right, so on the corporate track, you have 3500, that's modeling. You have 3610, that is the forecasting class. I'll come back to the START course. And then you have a series, again, of elective investments courses. These are anything from, commercial banking, analysis of securities, the fixed income class. That's the difference between holding stock or issuing debt or bonds, okay? So you'll learn about these different securities that operate within our financial markets. 3700 is starred because These are our special topic courses. It's important when you're looking at your schedule that you pay attention to them because they can have different titles. 3700 is sort of a catch-all for any course that is not regularly on our quarter, agenda. All right, so this could be the derivative course. We have derivative courses. We have travel courses. I'll talk about them later on down the line. But 3700, these are elective courses that are encompass our special topic courses. All right? Any questions? Awesome. All right. So now I'm going to turn it over to Jeff. He's going to start talking about careers and what you may be thinking, regardless of whether you want to stay here in Denver or potentially go abroad.
I'm going to make the big assumption that all of you at some point in time are planning on being gainfully employed. Good thing, right? What we want to talk about is what do those prospects look like and what are those options? How many of you guys want to stay here in Denver?
Raise them high, higher.
So a reasonable proportion of you. So let's talk, first of all, in three big buckets. One, what do finance careers look like in Denver, and what are the options here and in the Front Range? Two, how do those career paths change, and what is different if I move to a larger US-based organization? And what changes again when I start looking at a large global multinational or business in a foreign country? So the first part, Denver. How many of you would agree with the following statement? 75% of the businesses in the Front Range have 50 employees or less.
True.
So, first thing you need to know, landscape. We do not have a large number of Fortune 500 firms. What does that mean for you as an individual coming into an entry-level position in finance? It rearranges the landscape somewhat. So, on the sheets that you've been handed out, you'll see summaries of each of these big buckets. And I'm going to trust that you guys, at this point in time, all know how to read. So I will leave you to read those. If you want additional information, you can certainly follow up with any of us in Career Services. You can go to the Vault documentation, which you can get to through Pioneer Careers. You can go to Investopedia, which is terrific from the standpoint of both career advice and talking about specific financial instruments. So when Venetia introduces financial modeling, what is that? If you want to know what it is before you get to that class, go to Investopedia and just type in financial modeling. Google is your friend. Use it. What changes for you, however, is the order and the structure of the careers in finance. So corporate finance, we talked about that initial class. We talked about the need to utilize accounting information and data. But corporate finance functions really talk about how does the business operate, how does it use money, and how does it stay in business? So those are the great things that you get to work with. So when Venetia points out that there is an accounting class required, guess what? You need to know accounting. You need to know where the data is coming from. You need to know how it gets used. You need to know how to correct it. You need to know how to talk about it. All of that sits in the corporate finance space. So those three functions, financial planning and analysis, which is really looking at modeling, budgeting, forecasting, planning for the ongoing operations of the firm. Two, the actual business finance functions, which means I'm the grunt who has to work with everybody and make sure we don't go bankrupt, basically. You're going to be doing budgeting. You're going to be doing a lot of spreadsheet work. You're going to be doing a lot of cooperative meetings with other functions because as the business finance individual, you need to make sure that your workforce planning is on target, that your salary budget is fine, that you know what your benefits are doing, that you know how your inventory is structured, that you know what your operating costs are going to be and how those are going to be managed. So those are the big buckets that sit in that corporate finance function. Here in Denver, because so many of the firms are smaller, the option to specialize in one of those areas, less so. So plan on being a financial generalist. That means you're not only going to be involved in planning for the business, and you're probably going to be sitting in the room with the owner or the chief executive officer and the other individuals that are operating the company, but you're going to have to cover functions that you might not expect, like, I don't know, payroll, benefits, inventory management, operational processing and operational planning. So these corporate finance roles here in the Denver marketplace, in the main, are composite finance roles where you really need to get into the grunt work of running and managing the corporation. So pay attention to your management classes, pay attention to all of the things that deal with how do I run a meeting, how do I plan a project, how do I manage others. That's the difference that you'll find between that local corporate finance function and, as we talk about the more specialized finance functions, as we get into the broader, larger companies. Insurance and wealth management is really big here, because in case you haven't noticed, a lot of extremely wealthy individuals are moving here to retire, and they are all bringing the need for that expertise with them. So these would be all of your insurance companies, which now not only provide insurance, but provide securities and mutual funds and other customized investment vehicles, as well as the wealth management companies like J.D. Edwards, Raymond James, Merrill Lynch Wealth Management, Wells Fargo Wealth Management. All of those individuals are dealing with ensuring that individuals can live the lifestyle that they want. Many of these are also overlapping here because they help plan individually owned companies. If it's mine and it's privately held, many times my investment manager will be intimately involved in managing the business and ensuring that my personal wealth, which is tied up in that business, is used correctly. Consumer and commercial banking, you all know when you walk across the street to the branch or you go to the U.S. branch bank over in Driscoll, welcome to the world of consumer and commercial banking. If you happen to be a business and you need a loan to finance your building, you're probably going to come talk to a commercial banker. If you need a loan for your car, you're probably going to go talk to a consumer banker. So that's the traditional banking space. That exists pretty consistently across the spectrum. The difference in Denver is that the finance functions are directly engaged in client contact. Most of the main banks are not headquartered here. So those finance functions, from the standpoint of financial planning and analysis, and from actually helping to manage the firm, are at a headquarters, or at a regional headquarters at the least somewhere. We have some of those here, but those jobs will be more difficult to find. So notice we're walking down the change of where the most are to where the least are. Non-banking FIs include things that provide financing services, but are not strictly a bank. We have one large Fortune 500 non-banking financial institution here in Denver. Anybody know what it is?
Aero. Aero Electronics.
So they do financing in a part, but not their main business. Where is it that it's their main business?
Gyms.
Capital management. So not exactly in this bucket. They come into the investment in the asset management space. I'll give you a hint. If you're a foreign national and you need to send money home, how do you do that? Western Union, headquartered here, is one of the largest money transfer organizations. They provide what's known as non-banking financial services. So those are the types of things that you're seeing now more and more. A lot of that is online. So Ally Bank, they have a bank, but they also have a ton of services that are non-banking related that link to insurance products and to other things, because guess what? They used to be GE Capital. So that is how those things play in. There are opportunities here in that Western Union type of activity where you can do traditional corporate finance functions. So that is a place to just do your research, find them. They're not exactly what you expect, but they do have jobs available in the strict finance function. Investment and asset management, you guys have already hit on. We do have Janus Capital, we have operations for Oppenheimer, we have basically customer service functions for Schwab and Fidelity. They all have specific finance-related positions. They tend to be more focused on budget and project management because these organizations out here are about direct client contact. And the biggest pieces that you're going to have to budget are, like Schwab is redoing their entire front-facing platform for clients. There are finance individuals who are doing the expense management, the budget planning, and the project planning for all of that. So those are additional spaces in investment and asset management, aside from moving back to the investment track, actually doing research, actually providing recommendations on which stocks should be incorporated into a fund, which one should be included and offered to our clients because we believe that they are an appropriate investment. So those are the core things. The one on the bottom, I put it on there because we have a lot of it here. There are over 250 individual private equity firms in Colorado. The good news is you may have opportunities to do an internship there. The bad news is, when you go and research those firms, and you should, look at who is on their staff. You'll find that they have analysts, and they're mostly interns, and then nothing until you hit VPs. Why? Anybody want to take a stab at why that's the case? So private equity firms make money how? Through client contacts that want to engage in some form of financial structuring that can't be done in a normal bank. That means you need to be bringing contacts to me. You need to be telling me who I have to partner with. There's nothing between the analyst and the VP positions because those VPs come from top-tier investment banks, and that's who gets hired. So when you start looking at the site, you'll see where they all come from. The great news about that is that when you start moving over here, there are opportunities for you to boomerang back. You can be the VP that comes back and does private equity in Denver. So just be aware that there are very specific things that they look for. And it's easy to find if you go to the largest ones, and you can go to the Denver Book of Lists in the library and scan down the top 25. Find out who they're hiring from, what businesses they are attracted to. Most of them have a specific specialization in an industry. And start looking at internship programs at an investment bank. This is one of the reasons why we're really focusing on internships, because they're really important for that. Many of the investment banks hire 80 to 90% of their full-time hires directly from their internship programs. So it's a big deal getting that internship. So let's talk about, just briefly, U.S. U.S., more opportunities, more mobility. You can go and touch firms that are larger and global in nature and that have very specific functions. The corporate finance functions are really going to center more heavily around narrow niches. If you're doing financial planning and analytics, you're not touching payroll other than somebody giving you a number that goes in your model. If you're doing treasury services, you're doing modeling and getting it from the financial planning, you're talking to the investment banking folks and you're saying, how am I going to finance the firm? Do we have enough operating capital to keep us in business? And if not, do we issue stock? Do we do debt? What do I need to do to make sure that the firm is financed? So that treasury function starts to be really important once you get over here into the US. If you're not a large multinational and you are not actively looking at the stock market from the standpoint of providing cash and capital for your business, probably less of an issue, and you're probably not going to find that many treasury functions here, although Arrow Electronics does have a really good one. They are one of our multinationals. So that's a little different. Consumer and commercial banking has many more opportunities from the standpoint of financial analysis for the branch network. They have specific individuals who work in finance covering marketing and product development within that space. And they have specific headquarters positions where, again, you're going to be focusing on one of those particular aspects of finance f- for a financial institution. Different from a regular corporation, much more highly regulated, somewhat more complex. So really interesting positions that become available to you when you look at these larger financial institutions. Insurance and wealth management tend to be the same types of positions. If you're really good at establishing relationships and you're really good at planning people's lives with input from them, those are great positions for you. You can build your own independent business within many of those organizations. That's the whole point. You establish that relationship, you own it. So it just gets very different when you get to the larger institutions. Why? Because they're dealing with multimillionaires instead of just millionaires. Requires more analysis, requires more information, requires more research and assessment, so much greater opportunity when you move to those larger markets. Investment and asset management, again, gets larger and more complex. Things are starting to merge between those two. So you have firms like BlackRock, who are really not only an investment house, but a wealth management house, and overall non-financial banking house, because they have reams of capital that they go through and distribute. So those things tend to be somewhat different. You'll also find when you get into this investment and wealth management space that you find non-traditional players who have really established a huge presence there and are now offering traditional banking services. We have one that recruits on campus for research analysts in Salt Lake. Who would that be? Bingo. So they have moved from really being an investment house to being focused on not only the investment banking pieces, but also, once I've generated that deal and I've spun off all this cash, how do I help my clients manage it? So very different approach. Things are starting to blend and merge as you get larger and larger. You're looking for revenue. You're looking for options to provide your clients. You're looking for options to generate additional income for your shareholders. So you're going to start seeing that happen here. In the global space, same large multinational issues that we saw in the US, but what really changes in the global space is the regulatory environment. It will not be at all what you're used to here. Things do not function in the same way. You'll find a lot of these will be similar, but you'll find in the corporate space, you have very specialized functions that sit between finance and risk management that are totally related to government relationships. I don't know, Bank of China might be one. So there are specific individuals who deal with those regulations and relationships from a non-US structural standpoint. So just like you guys would be worrying about the Fed, if I was a banker in China, I'd be worrying about the Bank of China and what they're doing. So that's what changes in those spaces. The other thing that really begins to break down are these last three segments, that investment management, the non-banking financial institutions, and that overall insurance and wealth management piece. They really merge and intersect. In the high net worth space, especially in some of the foreign countries, you will find very loose regulation. It is really difficult to tell what kind of product something is because it may be customized for one individual. You're thinking, yeah, one individual doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter unless they have $1 billion that they're going to invest in it. Then it matters. So things just change from that standpoint. So regulation, sizing, and the need to really run relationships for ultra high net worth individuals really change the global marketplace. So I'm hoping that that is helpful in kind of saying, where do those things sit and where do they go? I trust that you're going to read what's on the sheet and you're going to poke around with those things. If you have questions, come in and ask us. Ari and I will be happy to fill you in on what we've seen in that landscape and what we think those options might be. But it's really going to be up to you to land what you would like to do, what floats your boat, so to speak. You know, if you are in a class and you take your homework out of that class and you find you're doing your homework and you missed lunch and you really don't care that you missed lunch because, wow, this was such a great project, you might want to think about that particular area and where that applies from a career standpoint. Flow is a good thing. You want to be there as much as you possibly can. So with that, I am going to turn that back over to Anisha. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, that's
all right.
That's
okay. I missed that spot. That's why she's here. She has to remind me what I missed. I am actually supposed to talk to you about skills. So the reason it's kind of in this kind of odd teeter-totter is recruiters are really looking for balance in that space. You have to have the soft skills, and you have to have the hard skills. Some positions lean more towards one or the other, but you are never going to be allowed to be out of balance between those two. So when we talk about the soft skills, it's really that ability to relate to people, that ability to communicate and to persuade individuals about your recommendations, your ideas. When we say communication, bear in mind, it's not just being able to talk. If you suck at writing, go to the Writing Resource Center. Learn how to write. It will be critical to what you do. Difference between writing a research report and writing an email, bear that in mind, but you still need to be able to write clearly and communicate effectively in print as well as when you're in a meeting or presenting. Decision-making, problem-solving, and initiative is really how do I think? Did I learn how to approach a problem? And can I take it apart and put it back together in a way that makes sense and provides a solution? And lastly, you look at those and you think, that's kind of weird kind of a grouping. It's like, what's with that focus thing? Flexibility and adaptability are easier in your generation because you get to bounce around to a bunch of things. You live on social media and multimedia and Twitter and everything else where you're constantly changing subject every 5 seconds. That's great, and they look for that, and it's important. But when you have a financial planning project that's due in 6 hours, you better be able to focus on that and nothing else. No picking up the phone, no looking at social media, no leaving the topic until it's done. So you will find, you will get some odd questions asking you about, can you focus? Can you get something done in a really compressed timeline when you're required to think of nothing else? Those are the soft skills. These, I will leave for your classwork. You will have classes in all of those. But one thing I will reinforce, Excel. You will live and die by that application. It will be a good 10 to 15 years into your career before you can afford to ignore it. And then miraculously, you will get in a meeting with other senior managers, and somebody will give you a spreadsheet that makes absolutely no sense. If you don't remember how to dissect that thing and come up with the correct answer in about 5 minutes, you're probably not going to be in that meeting the next time. So pay attention to that. Pay attention to how it operates. Pay attention to what it focuses on. Pay attention to how it communicates information. It's very specific, but you need to be good at it because that is a live and die skill. So if you guys have questions about these, sorry I missed that. I'm all about the career space.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. All right, so I'll just make one more comment on this slide here, just to make sure you're clear. When you're in your courses, the hard skills are the ones you're going to pick up, right? The thing to note is that what's going to make you different from your friend that's graduating from Boulder or Metro are these soft skills. Because when an employer hires you, they're going to assume you have this. We've given you a degree, they're going to assume that you have this knowledge. The difference will be how you communicate, how you're able to build these relationships with clients. So how do you pick up these skills? If you don't necessarily get them in the classroom, per se, how do you get them? This sort of leads us to some of the more specialized courses offered through the Ryman School of Finance. So what are the more popular courses or opportunities that our students take advantage of? The first are our experiential learning courses. The one that we usually promote the most is the Ryman Fund. This is a course where you're actually managing real money, okay? So you're making the investment decisions, you're analyzing which securities to go long or to purchase, which securities you want to short, which means sell. You're making these real live decisions. This is exactly what you would do if you were hired by an investment firm. They're going to walk you through, Chris Hewen teaches this class most of the time. So what you'll do in this class is walk through from beginning to end. What are the first questions you ask about forming a portfolio? All the way through, how do we rebalance the portfolio? When do we sell this stock versus purchase this stock? And in what proportions? How do we allocate capital? Why is that important? Because many of the functions we saw back here in these top careers involve just that. So whether you're doing it for a client or for yourself, you could be doing it for the city of Denver because they have funds to allocate as well. They have a budget. They need to invest these funds so that they can make enough operating income to proceed with whatever projects they have. Okay, so our experiential learning courses are very, very popular. This course, I believe you have to apply. You have to talk to the professor to get in. Serious. It's a real endowment, and we've seen that endowment grow. I think the initial investment was somewhere around $500,000, and I think the current balance is about $1.2 million. So you are actually making these decisions. So it's a great course, all right? Then we have a series of travel courses. Any of you heard of the Walk Down Wall Street course? Anybody taken that here? All right, so we have these travel courses. These courses are great. And the only downside, technically, is that they generally have a course fee. So you're paying your tuition. They're all 4 credits. But there's generally a course fee associated with these travel courses to cover materials. Sometimes it covers the hotel because you're staying at a location for generally about a week and a half. Okay, so it's covering the materials, it's covering the expertise. We're tapping into people who on any given day are willing to spend 2-3 hours with you, and we're pulling them away from running a multi-billion dollar corporation. Okay, so there are a lot of things that go on in the background. So let me tell you a little bit about each. The first is the Organized Walk Down Wall Street. Dr. Macklin Klaus teaches this course generally. You go to Wall Street and you meet with some huge names. These are, to be quite frank, these are industries and firms that generally DU doesn't get in front of. I mean, these are firms that are generally pulling from NYU, the Ivies. Okay, we have very in-depth relationships with a lot of these firms. You're going to shake a lot of hands. You're going to learn to very deep detail what it means to be an investment banker, what it means to be in the private equity space, beyond just giving you a definition. But there'll be junior people there all the way up to senior people explaining to you. You may make 6 figures, but guess what? We're here 90 hours a week. Okay, you're going to learn about the lifestyle. Okay, you're going to learn about the cost of living. You're going to learn about the daily grunt work of doing any of these operations. So the Organized Walk Down Wall Street will introduce you to both the investment side as well as the corporate side. Okay, so you'll spend a week in New York. It's a very intense week. You start usually 9, go to 5, and you're meeting with people 5 days. Okay, you're going to shake a lot of hands, get a lot of cards. A number of our students have been hired by these firms, have either received internships, and some of them have been hired. Okay, you'll learn the importance of networking. It's critical. Okay, this is a great place to start. The second course encompasses our series of global travel courses. So we have travel courses where we actually go abroad. How many of you are interested in going abroad? I saw about wow, that is amazing. Good for you. So I hope you paid attention to what Jeff said. It's very different when you want to stay local versus when you want to open up and get into the global space. Now you're talking about a larger set of competition. okay? The competition changes, all right? And the job opportunities change, all right? So it's important to have these relationships. So the last course we've taught, we've been to Brazil. I've taken classes to Brazil. I have a lot of connections in Brazil. We've taken classes to London. We've taken classes to Brussels. Many places, okay? Again, amazing courses, because if you want to get into that international space, as Jeff said, it is critical to understand what the 9 to 5, or maybe 6 to 7, looks like, okay? It's critical, all right? I also teach a course in Chicago, where you will learn not only about derivatives, and so Chicago is sort of the options capital, okay? So the CBOE, the CBOT, you learn about the derivative space. Now, why is that important? You say, oh, that's such a small piece of the finance puzzle. The reality is that risk management is tremendous in the finance space. Whether you're a small player or a huge multinational company, every firm is involved in managing risk. And there are various types of risk that one needs to manage. But in Chicago, we focus on managing financial risk, for the most part, okay? And using derivatives to do so. So most of you have probably heard the term derivative, and you think, well, I thought derivatives increased risk. You know, that's sort of how we heard them described around the financial crisis. We'll learn about that. But in reality, the majority of options are used, and derivatives are used to help mitigate risk, to actually reduce risk. You will learn about the differences and how firms are actually using these instruments to save themselves or protect themselves from financial and operational risk, okay? So these are our travel courses. Look out for them. Again, remember we had that 3,700 starred. This is where these classes will be lumped, under 3,700. You just have to look at the title, all right? Last, we'll talk about the internships, and I'll say star, star, star. All of your coursework is critical, but the reality is when you get on the job, that's when the rubber really hits the road, okay? So you will learn about valuation, you'll learn how to use Excel, but it's not until you actually get into the workplace that you learn how to actually apply what you have learned, okay? We talk about those soft skills. This is where you'll pick that up. Why are internships critical? One, because the marketplace is requiring it. Please do not leave Raymond. We have not done our job if you have not at least sought out. You should leave here with at least one internship experience, okay? It is critical. If you go out just with a degree in tow, you're gonna be in a stack, particularly if you wanna go globally, you're gonna be in a stack of thousands of applicants, okay? What's gonna set you apart? When they say, well, wait a minute, we need someone that comes in and has a clue, because that saves them money and resources, right? Instead of having someone to sit with you for 6 weeks to explain to you what PE is, private equity is, you would have a clue because you've interned with someone for 6 months, okay? That is critical. Time is money. It is critical. You should not leave the Ryman School of Finance with a degree unless you have had an internship. This is why these people over here are critical. If you don't know where Career Services is, it's on the second floor. You should not leave this university without having visited these two men, these two gentlemen. And Pat, who runs the ship, right? So he's behind the scene, but he makes the whole ship operate, right? So he's trying to hide over there. We see you, Pat. Last thing I'll say about internships, you can receive 4 credits. You can receive credit for doing an internship. Please understand that there is a formal process in place. Please do not go off into internship. Well, do go off into internship land, but speak to us first. Because if you go and do an internship expecting that you can then retroactively come and say, hey, I did this wonderful thing, where's my 4 credits? You may have done yourself a disservice because we may not be able to give it to you retroactively. There is a process in place. Please come and speak to Ali. Raise your hand again, Ali, please. He is our internship coordinator. Please go and speak to him. We need to know the scope of the internship. We need to know what were you just pushing around papers, or were you in client meetings, shaking hands? Were you helping with the modeling functions? Makes a huge difference, okay? It's not just a simple 4 credits, but it's critical for your career and your advancement, okay? The last thing I'll say about internships, and I've been talking about this a while, but it's critical. It's better for you to learn what you want to do before you have a mortgage and kids, okay? That's not the time to say, oh, probably shouldn't curse, oh crap, I hate what I do. It's too many hours, I don't like the culture, but I have a $500,000 mortgage and twins, okay? Internships are critical. You're young, you don't understand this space. I'm still learning the space. There's something new in financial markets every day. Every one of these careers that we talked about here can be vastly different. Not only by title, but by locale. Vastly different. Yes, ma'am. Very good question. The travel courses are generally available to juniors and higher. Under some very, I'll say juniors and higher. I don't think I've ever seen a sophomore, maybe a very motivated sophomore, that you'd have to get approval for that, because these are 3,000 level courses, which generally correspond to, you know, our juniors, or once you get into your major, okay? But if you have specific questions, you can come see me. I am the graduate director of undergraduate, and the director of undergraduate programs in Ryman. So if you have specific questions, come talk to me. What year are you?
I'm a freshman.
You're a freshman. Good for you. All right. Any other? Yes, ma'am.
So are those classes quarter-long classes? I know you mentioned you'd be in New York for a week or a week and a half. So is it just?
Excellent question. Okay. So the structure will differ per the course.
Okay.
We sort of changed the structure. It used to be that it was an intensive 1 week course. But we've sort of shifted away from that, and now you'll have maybe 3 or 4 weeks of actual on-campus, in-class work, where you'll start work on a project, and then you'll have this intensive 1 week experience. The Brussels-London trip is about a week and a half. So what are the expenses associated with these travel courses? Again, there's generally a course fee, okay, and that can vary. Anywhere from $1,500 to $2,200, I think, is the highest I've seen. Sometimes that includes the hotel, sometimes it does not include the hotel. It never includes airfare, so you must be able to get to the starting location. Some students, depending on how or when these travel courses are offered, some students go early because they want to see London, they want to see Brussels. Oftentimes we'll have students that stay after the course is done and they'll travel around Europe. I took a class to Brazil, we were in São Paulo, and you know, most of the guys stayed afterwards and went all around, went to Rio and everywhere else, wherever they went. It's a great opportunity. Travel is a wonderful thing. You pick up different cultures, you learn to respect different cultures, and these are the same people you're going to see in the workplace. Okay, yes?
Is there like a certain time you should be getting internships?
Great question. Do you want to, you want to take that question? Is there a certain time when they should start looking for internships?
I'll take it first.
You want to take it, Pat?
Yeah.
Sure, please.
So last year, J.P. Morgan came here in February, and they only wanted to talk to freshmen and sophomores. So if you're thinking about a career in finance, yeah, you need to start thinking about it earlier. I'll give you an example. We have a rising junior now. He's going to spend his summer at J.P. Morgan in New York. Last year, so last summer, he did an internship with a local bank here in Colorado, right, as a rising junior. So yeah, you want to start thinking about this sooner rather than later.
Thank you, Pat. So you hear that. Freshmen, so don't wait until your senior year. Unfortunately, I get this in my office. I'm advising a student. I say, hey, I graduate in June. When should I start looking for an internship? You know, when's the app? And years ago. Good answer. You get an A. Years ago is the answer. And it's a sad situation when I have to look a student in the face and share that with them. They've missed the boat. But you know, a part of that's why these workshops are important, because we're trying to relay to you that there are timelines. And different internships will have different timelines. If you want an internship in the summer, you don't start looking in March, April, May. You don't start looking in May. Okay, well, the summer's right around the corner. Go and speak to these gentlemen, and they will help you understand these timelines.
In general, if you are looking for an internship with a large multinational in finance, regardless of whether it's banking or whether it's consumer products or any of the consulting firms, if you aren't doing recruiting over the summer for the internship that starts the following summer,
right,
you are late. Those decisions are made end of September through October. If you're not getting your applications in and talking to somebody and doing your networking during the summer, you're going to miss the window.
So again, I advise all of you to try to make an appointment with Career Services to understand this space. I don't work in it every day. I can do general advising, but I can't tell you about deadlines. They can. Make an appointment, make sure you get in their face. Okay, they'll talk to you about resumes, cover letters. These should be professionally done. A typo can count you out. It's critical. Attention to detail. What did Jeff say a few slides ago? Focus. Okay, if you can't spell your name right or you can't take the time to make sure a resume that you're going to send out to hundreds of people is correct, it's a reflection of you. Make sure you take the time. The resources are here. Okay? All right, let's move forward. What other opportunities are available to you outside of your coursework? Well, we have a number of student groups and other resources available. First club I want to tell you about is the Finance Club. If you're not already a member, it's a good opportunity to become a member of the Finance Club because we've just revamped it. We've just rebranded it. It was very specific to investment banking in the past, but now it's a more generalist club. Alex Tilton is here. She is one of the officers. She's great. We have a number of social events. I'll talk about them in a second. But it's $25, is it?
I think we're still figuring out.
We're still figuring.
Yeah.
So it's a $25 membership fee for the year, but that gives you access to all of our events, all of our speaking engagements, all of our socials. We have a social coming up on February the 16th that it's not called Spanky's anymore.
Urban Roadhouse.
Thank you very much. Urban Roadhouse will serve you food. So you think, why do we have to pay? You know, we're already paying tuition. Well, a lot of these events will have food and refreshments, and that is not free, unfortunately. So it's a small fee to get access to a lot of people and shake a lot of people's hands, okay? I'll talk to you about the February 16th event momentarily. Beta Alpha Psi, it's generally a more accounting-based organization, but it's an honorary organization that, again, gives you another opportunity to learn about leadership in the finance and accounting space, meet a lot of people, shake hands. Alex?
I was going to say, while we're still getting the email up and running, if you do want to learn more about the Finance Club or you're
yes.
interested in joining, feel free to email me. It's just my first name, full first name dot last name at du.edu.
If you want to just write it up, Alex.
Yeah.
If any of you have questions about the Finance Club before you leave, just talk to Alex, okay? Again, that gives you access to all of our events. All right, Beta Alpha Psi again, gives you another opportunity to shake hands, learn about leadership in the finance field, another wonderful networking opportunity, okay? You'll realize a little later on, you may not realize it now, how critical networking is, okay? A lot of jobs are gotten because of someone you knew or through contacts. It is absolutely critical. So the more hands you can shake, you may think, oh, I'm tired, I've been in class for 6 hours today, there's an event tonight. That event could change your life because that card, that business card you receive could lead to that internship that leads to that job. This is exactly what happens in the real world. You have to be willing, after work hours close, to keep that networking going, okay? This is real world, this is real life. Then Career Services. I've been singing their praises this whole time. Again, second floor of Daniels. There's Pat, Jeff, Ollie. You should not leave without going to that office. It just should not happen. Okay, you have to go visit them. Academic advising at the undergraduate level is Greg Grobberger. There's his extension. If you have questions about your coursework and making sure you graduate on time, if you're looking to do a dual major or a minor, you should talk to Greg. All right. We'll quickly run through this because we're running short on time. There are a number of professional organizations and certifications that are associated with the finance degree, and Jeff is going to run through them quickly. Just it's important to mention, the CFA is probably one of the most recognized professional organizations for finance. Our finance program, the Ryman School of Finance, holds a CFA recognition. That means if you are interested in holding this designation, that our coursework, once you complete our coursework, you will have covered the significant amount of the material covered on this exam. So it is critical. If you want to get this certification, which, you know, is highly recommended, you're in the right place. Jeff, thanks.
Cool. The reason why I want to talk about certifications is because although you're probably not going to be eligible for any of these three for 3 to 5 years after you graduate, use the websites. These are great sources of information about what is covered under the certification. What are they focusing on? Make sure that your classes that you're taking address those issues and items so that you come out prepared. The CFA Institute, not only do we cover most of the body of work, it is specifically focused on financial analysis for corporations. How do you value them? How do you plan for them? How do you recommend stocks? It is that investment-focused certification. So you'll see that when you're looking in the private equity space here and those firms, you'll see a lot of individuals have that certification. The Financial Planning Association and a certified financial planner, slightly different. They are generally focused on individuals. The certified financial planner laps more into the how do I plan for family succession? How do I plan for business transitions? So take a look at those. Here in Colorado, that space, that planning for private individuals who have a privately held firm and managing that firm through a transition is a great stepping stone and an alternative stepping stone into the private equity and the middle markets investment banking space. So once you've got that set of context and that expertise, that's another way you can approach that. So those are the three things that I encourage you to take a look at. It's easy enough to Google them, you'll find them, they'll pop right to the top of the screen. Just take a look at that. Use that in conjunction with the folks in academic advising to explore what you want to cover and how you want to address that skill set. Okay?
All right, we're going to wrap up here. We just want to tell you about two more things. For one, for those of you who are interested in joining the Finance Club, we have what we're calling a meet, greet, and eat at Urban Road, what time is it? Spanky's Urban Roadhouse. Thank you, kindly. It's February the 16th. It's a Thursday. Tentatively, we'll send an email blast to everyone. But tentatively, it's 5:30 to 7:30. There will be food, lots of food, wings, so free dinner, right? But the more important part is you will have an opportunity to shake hands with some very high-level people. We'll have Max Bull as well as Mr. Eric Miller. Both of these gentlemen, Max is from Morgan Stanley, and Eric is from Kodiak Building Partners. Again, we're going to be in a small space. I mean, these are the type of events you want to attend. A small space where you're going to shake someone's hand and look them in the eye, okay, and say, hey, right? And you say, you know, hi, my name is Catherine, and, you know, I'm interested in learning more about what you do. I'm also, you know, we'll prep you on some of these things, but it's critical. There will be about 40, 50 of us there in the room. We'll have their full attention. These are the type of events you want to attend, right? It's very critical. So again, if you have questions about the Finance Club, speak to me or Alex. One last thing, I would just like Allie, because internships are so important. Allie, if you take like 2 minutes, 3 minutes, sorry to cut you short, just to tell them what the process is for internships now.
Just 1 minute.
1 minute, okay.
Well, first of all, thank you for being here. We are working very hard to have a new process for the internships. I encourage all of you to stop by the career services. We'll give you all the information. We'll describe the whole process. And to reinforce what all of them have been saying is, take time to think about this. If you're gonna go into a finance career, Jeff has a lot of years to share with you guys, Pat, myself, we are all bankers, ex-bankers. And that's a good thing, being an ex-banker. I think that's wrong. And we can help you guys, we can go through your expectations, and we can really, really, really help you to really focus on what you wanna do in those internships. And we are investing a lot of resources and time as a school to get this together and just help you guys as a very important part of your career. Not only the skills that you're getting, as Jeff was saying, but all those soft things that you need to learn when you are standing in front of an employer. So we're there, all of us.
Ali is also in career services on the second floor of Daniels.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
The last slide, just your department contact. The director of the Ryman School, we call it a director or the chair, whatever you want to call it. It is Dr. Macklin Klaus. Here's his email and his direct extension. And then you have my contact information. As an I'm the undergraduate programs director, so if you have program specific questions, I'm the contact person for that. Here's my email address as well as my direct number. All right? Yes?
All right, so I want 30 seconds. Because one thing I noticed that wasn't in the presentation was, why bother majoring in finance?
Ah.
Oh, yeah.
You know? So, hey, so first, I'm glad you're all here. So the important thing about finance is every single company has a finance function.
Yes.
Yep. Nonprofit, for-profit, public, private is a very transferable skill. So you want to have options over your life, and you can have lots of different jobs. Finance opens those doors. And like all the liberal arts folks hate it, finance makes the world go round. Don't forget that. Every decision is business decision has a financial component to it. So, you want to have a really interesting, varied career, finance can bring that to you. And so, we have a great partnership with the Ryman School of Finance. You know, Ali said we have a lot of years of finance experience in career services, so we're very dedicated to making sure you guys have options to, you know, launch your career great right after you graduate. But the reality is, you have to start working on your career early. Don't wait. All right, so thanks for being here. Do you have some other stuff?
No, that's it.
All right.
Thank you,
thank you guys.
Too.